Hi, everybody. My name is Dr. Kellie McElhaney. You know why the entire audience claps? Because I've been here 20 years. So I'm going to take that as a good thing. But no, I am really, really excited. I can't believe this is our 11th. Like, that just blows me away. Our 11th, I almost said TEDx. This is even better. Our 11th HaasX. And HaasX was Tenny Frost's brainchild. She does not like me giving her credit, so I'm going to start with that. So. And honestly, I was really lucky that Tenny asked me to MC 11 years ago, and I'm still here. And it is absolutely my favorite event of the year, and we do a lot of events here at Haas. So as I said, my name is Kellie. I've been here at Haas for 20 years. My current pot in which I grow is that I founded and run our Center for Equity, Gender, and Leadership. I also teach classes in that area, equity, fluent leadership, in all of our degree programs, and right now a lot in executive education. So I'm traveling the world a lot with Berkeley Executive Education Center for Equity, Gender, and Leadership, or EGAL, or as my board chair, Larissa Rush, who speaks French, EGAL. We exist here really to help develop leaders who are equity fluent in all forms of that word. So we look at equitable products and services, equitable cultures, equitable systems and processes, and then equitable leaders. I don't know if you know this, but because of the growth of our undergraduate program, we graduate 1,500 leaders a year from this school. That's a lot of leaders that we're developing and unleashing into the world. And so the simple mission for EGAL is to graduate 1,500 equity fluent leaders. And the other simple mission, it sounds so simple, but it is to ignite and accelerate change. And you know, the word accelerate kind of bums me out because we aren't accelerating on equitable change. So that's really where we spend most of our time. Today is not about me. Today is about these incredible speakers. I just get to weave them all together and riff off their brilliance. So I'm only going to say two things Tenny will want me to say. Hashtag Haas reunion. Hashtag Haas alumni. Hire Haas. No, that's at the end. I won't say that. What was I going to say? No questions. Sorry. We decided it was even better if we do this rapid fire, blow your mind, and then send everybody out to drink in the courtyard. And then you have questions. Yeah. Particularly Carlos's crowd, who may or may not have already started drinking. All right, our first speaker is Newton Cheng. He is full-time. Newton is full-time MBA 2008. The title of his talk, before I say a few words about Newton and then a few personal words, because I've had the great fortune of hanging out with him, Breaking the Stigma, What Happened When I Showed My Mental Health Struggles to the World. He is husband and father to two wonderful daughters via adoption, and I think it just got formalized 2 weeks ago?
Yes.
So, big congratulations. You may be able to observe that he is also a world champion competitive power lifter. That's not powerlifting. That's powerlifting. And that's me and my little Peloton 5-pounders. And he is the director of health and performance at Google. He has spent his 14-year career at Google developing, launching, and scaling programs around the world aimed at something that might be important today more than ever, the physical, mental, social, and spiritual health of the Google community, their families, which I think is a beautiful extension, and our neighbors. Newton also, I teach a class for student athletes here at UC Berkeley, and Newton was my first guest speaker this semester, and absolutely blew their minds. So over to you, Newton.
In November 2021, I was about to have a pinnacle moment for my career. I was scheduled to give the keynote at a Google Health and Wellbeing conference to a room full of experts and thought leaders. This was an amazing opportunity for me to showcase the work that I am so proud of. And so the weeks leading up to that, I spent hours crafting and practicing and polishing that talk because it had to be perfect. 3 days before the talk, I made a painful decision and I threw the entire thing out. And instead, I told them what was really going on. That I was struggling with depression and anxiety, and I'd be going out on mental health leave. And I knew so many others were struggling just like me, and that's what we needed to talk about. I have over 20 years of experience in health and well-being, and via my journey to becoming a world champion powerlifter, I've become an expert at the intersection of health and well-being and human performance. And despite all of that, I still burned out. Why? Yes, I was struggling with depression and anxiety. But the harder thing to admit is I did it because I was ashamed of how I was showing up as a husband and father. And I was terrified of hurting those that I loved most. And going on leave was an act of desperation because I didn't know what else to do. I spent the coming months on leave taking a really hard look at myself. And honestly, there were a lot of things where I didn't like what I saw. But eventually, I came back in a better place and with new insights and new mindsets and new tools for managing my mental health. And most importantly, I came back with a determination to help others who were struggling like me. So when the opportunity came up to be on a men's mental health podcast, I jumped on it. And I went on and I told my story as openly and vulnerably as possible. And then I very reluctantly posted it on LinkedIn in front of my entire professional network. That post got 2,000% more engagement than any of my normal posts. And then more podcast requests came in, and then requests for talks, and then requests to turn those talks into workshops for teams and organizations, because there was just such a desire to have these vulnerable conversations actually out in the open. Now, one particularly scary speaking engagement was presenting live to the 1,300-person organization that I work for at Google. And what made this even trickier was that I was doing the presentation from a room in Los Angeles into a tiny laptop camera that beamed the message to rooms around the world and then primarily to a conference room here in the Bay Area where the bulk of the organization sat. And I could not see anyone's face the entire time. And so I finish, and who knows what happened. But then a message came in from my boss, and it said, "Your words had impact. The room is dead silent." And I thought, did I touch people's hearts, or did I publicly commit career suicide? But then the next message came in, and it said, "Right now, I'm hiding in the back of the room, choking back tears, because for the first time in such a long time, I feel seen. Thank you." Messages like that one flowed in for the rest of the day and the rest of the week. So many of us were struggling, some working right next to each other, and we all hid it due to stigma. Now, that was pretty scary, but my scariest audience was yet to come. Growing up, we didn't talk about mental health, but I decided I'm going to break that cycle with my daughters. So a few months ago, I sat down my older daughter, and I said, "I have something important I need to tell you. Right now, I'm struggling with something called depression, and what that means is that sometimes, even though there's nothing wrong, I feel a little bit more sad, and I feel a little bit more tired. But I want you to know, even when I feel that way, it's going to be okay, because I will always take care of you, and I will always love you." And she smiled back at me and said, "I love you too, Daddy." And then I said, "Can I have a hug, because that would make me feel so much better?" And then she looked at me with that perfect child innocence and screamed, "No!" And laughed in my face and ran out of the room. And so that stung real bad. And I really wanted that hug, but I'm going to take that as a huge, huge win. Because even though she knew I was struggling, she felt like she could be a kid. So that's how I'm trying to break the stigma. After dozens of talks and dozens of workshops and millions of impressions on social media, I'm going to keep telling my story as long as people will listen. And what about you? How might you help break the stigma with so many struggling right now? And you're going to have to decide that for yourself, but I'm going to leave you with this. Imagine if we all showed up with just a little bit more vulnerability and courage. And in doing so, we put aside our perfectly polished exteriors and showed a little bit more of our hearts, wounds, scars, and all. If we could do that, what would that do for you and your family? And what would that mean for those you work with, and especially those you lead? And if collectively we could start a movement, what change might be possible for the world? Thank you.
Thank you.
So you can see why he might have blown my student athletes out of the water, because let me just tell you, having two full-time jobs at the top number one, at the number one public institution in the country, has had a huge mental toll on all of us, but these student athletes are really struggling. So when Newton came in, it was unbelievable. Hidden struggles. I mean, in this room, imagine how many hidden struggles there are with your teams, with your leaders into whom you report. And this gets right into bias and assumptions that we make about people. Burnout. I think my favorite thing that Newton talks about is vulnerability and courage. What would the world look like if we had more leaders who acted out of vulnerability, which takes a hell of a lot of courage? I cannot even imagine how you felt when you put that LinkedIn post up, or, you know, that moment. So thank you so much, Newton. Number two, we have Erin Gums. Erin is, Erin is a full-time MBA graduate from 2018. The title of her talk, Is It About Cookies or Comforts? Erin grew up here, right down the road in Oakland. Go Oakland, we live in Oakland. Prior to Haas, she worked in strategy for education nonprofits for nearly a decade. Currently, she is a brand and marketing leader at EA, Electronic Arts. Erin is also a certified professional coach where she supports mission-driven leaders to achieve alignment in their life and their career. She recently found herself with a lot more free time, so a long-time hobby blossomed into a venture that led to some unexpected lessons for both her personal and professional life. Erin.
Thank you all for tuning in today. Today we're going to be making breakfast. So you want to get your bowl out, have all your ingredients ready, and then you grab your box of cereal, you pour that in the bowl, your milk, and I like to have toast on the side. Do you like toast? Yeah. So you stick that in this thing and you press the button down, and when it's ready, make sure you put the butter on right away. And you grab your favorite spoon and you dig in. And enjoy. So some kids had an imaginary friend. I had this imaginary cooking show. And no matter how simple the recipe, I was narrating whatever it was I was doing in the kitchen and connecting with my imaginary audience. So it's no wonder that when in the spring of 2020, I found myself with an abundance of free time, I was feeling a little sad, a little bored and lonely, that I turned to the kitchen for inspiration and connection. So I remember this cookie recipe, chocolate chip cookies, that I made a lot over the years, and so I made some for myself just to feel better, I guess. And soon I was having 2 to 4 freshly baked cookies a night, 4 most of the time. And I'm spreading the love, you know, to my family and friends, and some suggested, like, you should really consider selling these. So I'm mulling that over, and one day I get a call mid-workday from my grandma. So I'm a little worried because she doesn't normally call me in the middle of the day. I'm like, hey, is everything all right? She's like, yeah, no worries. I just needed to tell you something. I want these cookies next to me at all times. And I was like, all right, that feels like her blessing, and it felt like the push I needed to get started. So with that, Cole Cookie Company was born. I posted my first official Instagram post about cookies on July 4th, 2020, and the process began. Orders started rolling in, 5 orders a week, 10 orders, 12. And soon this thing grew to something that I never imagined when I first started. So I knew I'd be baking cookies, but soon I'm reconnecting with Haas classmates that I haven't seen in the 2 years since graduation. I have old high school friends reaching out that I haven't spoken to in ages. And I had no idea that it was going to grow into this. I had complete strangers showing up to my door to pick up their cookie orders. One of the most meaningful things that I was able to do, though, was lead a holiday donation drive where people from all over, because I was doing it locally, people were, you know, from across the country, like, can I do something? And I got this idea to deliver cookies on people's behalf to essential workers at the time. So healthcare providers and community leaders who were providing care on the front lines to our community during the pandemic. So this was all unexpected, to be connecting with such a broad community in this way. And I was on a high from all of it. I was like, this is so cool. I didn't know that this idea that I had would grow into something like this. So I'm out one day on deliveries, and I'm in San Francisco on this hill looking down over downtown, and I'm knocking on the door of an old friend that I haven't seen in a while. And so he opens the door, I hand over the order, and he says, thank you, you know, we make a little bit of small talk. And then he goes, so you're doing cookies now. You just forget about that whole MBA thing. I was like, that's a bit harsh. but, you know, it really sat with me. I felt a knot in my stomach because I felt a little embarrassed, really misunderstood, right? I'm like, this guy has no idea why I'm doing this. And I'm not doing this to, like, add something to my resume. But it stung a little, stung enough that I was kind of considering, you know, is what I'm doing, is it silly? Does this mean that all that hard work and that MBA I got is going to waste? So I knew that I needed to regroup and reconnect with why I started this in the first place and, you know, my why. So I did what any good MBA would do, and I reached out to my network. I sat down with a dear friend, fellow Haasie and branding expert, who volunteered to take me through a workshop on my why and my core values for this brand I was building. And emblazoned on one of the slides was the question, is it about cookies or is it about comforts? And that really stuck with me. It kind of hit me because I was like, clear, so clear in my gut immediately that this was never about cookies. And it was certainly not about me aspiring to be the owner of some, like, nationwide chain of artisanal bakeries. It was about finding joy and connection in a period of widespread isolation and fear. It was born out of my imagination, and it taught me so much. It taught me that I could create something beautiful out of practically nothing. It taught me that I could find something that brings me joy and then, in turn, spread that joy to so many others. And it taught me the importance of remaining grounded in my why. Especially when, you know, this thing I'm feeling called to do, or you all are feeling called to do, doesn't make sense to others, when you're at the risk of looking silly, when it might not be deemed impressive or successful in the traditional sense. It only needs to feel right and true for you. So while Cold Cookie Company is no more, at least it's indefinitely on hold, it taught me so much, and its lessons are, you know, remain with me. So it gave me the courage to continue to follow my why, and a few years ago, I took the leap to become a certified professional coach. And in my work with clients, I'm focused on helping them gain a deeper connection to their why and align their lives and careers with their own individual definitions of success. So, I'm excited to see where this journey takes me next as I continue my journey in entrepreneurship. And I'm just so grateful for these lessons from Cold Cookie Company that I'm taking with me along the way. Thank you. Thank you so much. Nice job. Thank you.
wait, she didn't bring us cookies. I mean, that story is so beautiful because not only did the cookies help her connect to other people, they ultimately helped her connect with herself and her why. Joy, which is one of my favorite words, and I wonder if that person understands that you can have joy without being VC-backed. In fact, you probably have more joy without having those people behind you. But I think this question about what is your why is really critical, and life does not afford us a lot of time to think about that. I'm a little bit nervous to announce the next guest because I will be quiet for 5 minutes, but it is Carlos. Diéguez! Carlos, I should just start by saying this is his 25th reunion. 25th reunion. So that's why all the crowds. Carlos graduated in 1998. I bet you're faster than math than me, but that's 25. He started his career planning in a pretty conventional way, working in management consulting for McKinsey during his first year summer internship. It's not shocking that you took an unconventional turn. He made his first unconventional decision by not taking, McKinsey's offer. And instead, he went to a competing firm, A.D. Little. Then the internet bubble burst in 2001. He was lucky to secure an offer from the Mexican satellite company. He stayed there for 2 years before quitting and embarking on a 16-month sabbatical. I don't know how we're going to get there, but this experience ended with him distributing Brazilian bikinis, which his classmates found out about. The title of his talk is Just Don't Worry. Carlos.
Now we're talking. It is pitch black. I've just been dropped at a beach, desert beach, in the Brazilian island, which I was just brought there by a guy in a boat that I just hired half an hour ago. I dropped my stuff in my car, the rented car, and I started walking on the beach, totally pitch black, deserted. And I see a couple of buildings far away. And then they turn out to be a hotel. So walked in, it's almost midnight, and hey, how much is for the night? 20 reais, about $4. It includes breakfast. This is back in 2003. Now it would be like $3. And just walked in and just stayed at that island for a couple of nights. And I kept doing that for about 3 months. So what that trip brought me was just don't worry. Don't worry where you're going to be sleeping tonight. I had someone that changed my plans 2 days ago and ended up being homeless for Thursday night. I just went to a friend's, one of our classmates' gathering, and out of the blue, it was just like, stay here. So it just keeps coming back. But it's more than that. Seriously, don't worry. We tend to worry about things, and we should not be worrying, because things that we worry about are things that we cannot control. So we need to focus on the things that we can control and be able, you know, I'm not saying don't do anything like show up here like half an hour before the talk and then make Tenny a little skirt. But, you know, be in control of things that actually you are able to do something about. And just let these small things and things that you have no control just flow. Things tend to align. And it makes no sense in trying to control things that you have, or worry about things, sorry, that you have no control. So, but I would not be able to stand here and talk to you, you know, at a top-ranked business school and not give you some business advice, right? And actually, we've been here for about a week, some of us, and one of my friends told me, you need to say something about your current business, which actually happened to be born at that trip in Brazil. And so my advice to you is, you know, I sell swimwear for business. So as a bikini salesperson, I tell you, stay away from the bikini business. Because the margins are very thin. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for letting me share my experiences and thoughts with you today. That's all.
Thank you for becoming old, my daughter. Oh my God. I told him to keep that bikini away from my daughter. Carlos wanted some slides, we said no. Don't worry about what you can't control. No wonder you, oh my God, I don't even want to know what's been going on for the past week. Our next speaker, our fourth speaker, is Monica Brown. Monica got her MBA in 2003, which was when I got here. So I remember Monica very, very vividly because she's always the most bright, just effervescent person. She, as I said, full-time MBA 2003. She is a recovering workaholic and the proud mom to a four-year-old. Monica leverages her passion for education, kids, and play to help companies across the early childhood ed tech, gaming, and toy industries with their product, marketing, and brand strategy. Get this, the title of her talk, Stop Shoulding All Over Yourself. Monica.
Just going to start by saying the title is Shoulding, not Shooting, and not Shitting. So let's just get that straight. All right. So I walk into the office, and immediately my head jumps to everything I need to accomplish today. As a VP of marketing at LeapFrog, I've made it to the job I wanted. With the help of some Haas classmates and a lot of blood, sweat, and tears, I had actually made it to the goal I had set for myself here at Haas. In fact, right over there. So here I was, walking into the office, saying hello to my team, waving at the assistant, thinking about the board deck that I need to write today, and I get a text message from a friend of mine who used to work at LeapFrog. I can't believe who's buying LeapFrog. What? Excuse me? I don't know anything about that. So I run over to my desk, Google, find a press release that apparently came out that morning telling me that VTech, our largest competitor, had agreed to buy LeapFrog. What the fuck? Oh, I have worked here for 13 years, and this is how I find out? I'm on the leadership team, for God's sake. What the hell? I am so mad. But then I start thinking, oh my God, what's going to happen to my team? What's going to happen to me? How could this be happening? I'm going to get laid off. After everything I've put into this company, I am going to lose my job. My mind is, it's racing. And this feeling just starts welling up inside of me. Oh my God. I'm going to get laid off. Yes! How can I be happy? I've worked so hard for this. Where did this come from? And I realize, this is my should life. I am drowning, suffocated under my shoulds. what I should do, how I should do it, what I really need, should achieve. And in the process, I have completely lost me. What I need, what I value. I love my family. And I missed my niece's birthday for a retailer meeting. I love my friends. And I can't even count how many times I've canceled at the last minute for one business need or another. And I really want to build a family. I want to be a parent. But let's be honest, at 43, I am no closer to that than I was 10 years before. So here I am. It's a wake-up call. I have aligned my life around these shoulds. All of these shoulds, not just about my career. Hey, becoming a parent should be all about finding a partner, getting married, having kids, working on it together, right? I should be doing these things. But what if I had the courage to actually align my life around what I care about, what I value? What if I had the courage to try and really change the vision of where I'm going? So, fast forward 13 years. Actually, sorry, not 13 years. We already did 13 years. Fast forward to now. And here I am. Nowhere near the life I thought I would have. But I actually didn't get laid off. I quit that big job from Leapfrog. And I made my dream of becoming a parent a reality. So in December of 2018, my beautiful daughter was born. And it's been amazing. And in order to kind of reframe my life around me and my family, I had to walk away from what I thought my career should look like. But the reality is, I did not give up on my career. I just had to open the blinders and see that I could actually achieve the same impact. I could do what I love by just looking at it in a different way. So, here I am. I don't have the life that I thought I would have. And, you know, let's be real. Is being a self-employed single parent easy? Hell no, it is not. But is it worth it? I am happier, a happier human. I am more content and happy with my job. I am more me and more present in my life than I have been in so long. So, I would ask you, can we stop shooting all over ourselves? I mean, yuck. If your shoulds are making you happy, if they're worth it, then great, embrace them. But if they're not, why don't we take this moment to just let them go?
What's so immediately evident to me, Tenny and team select, it's super hard, right, out of the Haas alums that are out in the world to select amazing alums, but we don't know what they're going to talk about. And aren't you hearing some themes here around joy, meaning, courage? I mean, my palms were sweating when she was. We're doing a big project, two big projects, one with Google and one with Meta right now. So I'm just like, when she got that text, I'm thinking about everybody at Google and Meta who's been getting those texts around being laid off. So I'm imagining what they're feeling. And then when her happiness, it was just so evident. So it really is about this joy, happiness, which isn't easy getting there. Next, number five. Oh, yeah, hashtag Haas alumni, hashtag Haas reunion. That's what Tenny pays me right there. Benny Du is our next speaker, class of 2013. Where's Benny? Oh, there he is. I was like, oh, no, we lost him. 2013 from the full-time MBA program. He's a technologist at heart, and he's currently at this 760,000-people-strong company that is Accenture, figuring out how generative AI will transform our world. Before that, however, Benny had worked for organizations large and small, from consulting with the U.S. Navy to figuring out the future of work, sounds interesting, with an Andreessen and Horowitz-backed startup. The common threads, meaningful relationships built along the way, and a constant desire to learn new things. The topic title is Let's Not Talk About the Weather. Benny.
Hello, everyone. I'm honored to be in your presence. Oh, my goodness. I actually cringed as I was coming up with this title because I was thinking back to my childhood days living in Taiwan. I actually loved the weather. I wanted to be a weather report person. I drew maps, right? I cut out little circles, put it on those maps to track summer typhoons. Fast forward to present day, though. This is a typical Monday morning, 9 o'clock. I'm about to hop on an important client meeting on Microsoft Teams or Zoom. I have this, you know, nice shirt on. Lower body, doesn't matter. Let's not talk about that. People are trickling in. We're waiting for the right stakeholders to be on so we have quorum so we can get to the important topic of the day. Some people are on camera. Most of them are not. Some are muted. Some are not. You can clearly tell people are multitasking. There's dogs barking, kids running around. Oh, my goodness. And there's just this awkward tension. Like, and I'm just thinking to myself, man, I want to break this. How do I break this? So I'm going to go for it. I saw this guy from Chicago, and I said, hey, Jeff, how's the weather today in Chicago? And I could hear him typing, oh, you know, it's yeah, it's not cold anymore. It's, you know, spring. Yeah, it's great. It's, and no, and I'm like, damn, like, what do I say to that? Like, it's paradise in the Bay Area? And people started trickling in, oh, you know, the weather in Colorado and Miami, New York. But the irony is, I don't care. Like, I really couldn't care less about the weather, right? But that is what's going on, right? That's what I've been accustomed to when I see these people on these calls, in person, virtual. You guys know what I'm talking about, right? And this is the socially acceptable way of mindless chatter that we're all accustomed to now. And I'm thinking to myself, this is a little bit scary. I'm in the middle of trying to figure out ChatGPT, generative AI, what does that mean for the world? And I'm turning into a robot myself. This is not good. This is not good, right? Until one instance where this could no longer continue. This was a few years ago, around May, June timeframe. My mother-in-law, unfortunately, had gotten cancer. And it was to a very difficult part of her body to treat. And the medical team basically, you know, said we can't do anything. And she left us pretty soon after the initial diagnosis. They sent her home to hospice, and this was around 4th of July. And, you know, my son was almost one at the time, so I had a lot of thoughts going through my head, emotions, you know, the grief, but also a lot of gratitude. Grateful that, you know, she was able to spend, you know, the first year of his life, you know, together. So I sent my proper goodbyes, and she passed on the 4th of July, so 4th of July has a new meaning for my family these days. But 2 days after that, I had an important work trip to Bangkok, Thailand. And I had already made a commitment to participating. It was, you know, very important. But I wanted to make sure my wife was okay. I checked in on her. I actually got her blessing. She said, you made this commitment. I want you to go so you can fulfill your promise. But flying halfway around the world, you know, again, a lot of emotions through my head, right? The grief, how am I going to, you know, when will be a good time to tell my son about grandma, all of those things. I got to Bangkok, you know, saw some of the partners that I was working with, my colleagues, you know, said hello. And instead of asking about, you know, the weather or how was your trip, I basically told them straight up, this is exactly what I'm dealing with. Something terrible has happened in my family. This is what I'm going through, all my emotions. And immediately I felt the blinders sort of come down, right? We were not just focusing on the next client meeting, the set of KPIs we needed to meet, right? And that was such an aha light bulb moment for me, because then my colleagues started talking about their journey and how they could relate taking care of elderly parents. And we were bonding right then and there, halfway around the world in Thailand. So now, as the introduction probably said, I'm in this large company that is Accenture, 760,000 people. I challenge myself every day as a humble leader in this large company to not talk about the weather, to be more human. And we all see that. And I'm seeing that now. It's not just a large enterprise problem. In startups, too. I'm working with the startup. Everyone is, you know, going at 1,000 miles per hour. The perks are good. But I talked to one of my contacts, and I knew he had little kids. And I, on one of the calls, I basically just asked him, how are you doing? How are the kids? And he said, Benny, I've been here 4+ years at this startup. The culture's great. Everyone's great. Nobody has ever asked me this question. Another sort of light bulb moment for me. So that's really my message here, right? Let's all be more human, right? I think you're seeing that from some of these common threads here. Let's all be more human. The legendary coach John R. Wooden has an axiom: make each day your masterpiece. So let's all take it upon ourselves. As we go about painting our beautiful canvas every day, let's all lead with authenticity and purpose. And let's not talk about the weather. Thank you very much.
So my dad was an NFL football player. I might be a little bit competitive. Tenny's not going to like what I'm going to say. But as I'm listening to these talks, all I can think of is there is another school, South, and I guarantee you this is not the kind of message. Be more human, be more empathetic, be more courageous, stop shooting all over yourself. This is what makes Haas Haas. It just is. I know I'm not supposed to, I didn't say the name, Stanford. Number 6 in our talk lineup today is Alice Hansen. Alice is a little bit behind Carlos. She's at her 20th anniversary or reunion here. She was the member of our inaugural Berkeley Columbia Executive MBA program. She, after 15 years of consulting, she returned to corporate ranks in 2020 as an enterprise technology marketing executive. 6 months ago, she landed a very sought-after chief marketing officer role at a public security software company. For her, the C-suite elevation was new. She'd never worked before in a complex cybersecurity landscape, and the firm's transformation agenda was urgent. The title of her talk is Secrets, Vulnerability, and Energy. Alice.
Thank you. Wow. So it's November 2022. As Kellie noted, I was 6 weeks into a new job. If you'd looked at my LinkedIn profile, you would see that I've had a career in technology marketing. I know enterprise SaaS software really well. The cybersecurity thing, totally new, super technical. I have a lot to learn, and I got to hit the ground running. The immense pressure that I was feeling with all that is compounded. What you wouldn't see in my LinkedIn profile is that in early 2021, I had to leave my husband and relocate to a new home with my kids, who at the time were 11 and 14, new schools, And I was at that time, and am now, the sole financial provider for my family. I have to succeed in this new job. So November 17th, I'm at my standing desk at my home office in front of my home office bookshelves, well curated for Zoom meetings. And I've just presented to my boss, the CEO, my 45 days readout and signed up to deliver the first wave of marketing transformation in the next 45 days. The stakes are very high. November 28th, I'm back at my standing desk, and I have to write a terrifying email to my C-suite colleagues. Hello, everyone. I'm going to be out again this week, and I want to share why. My ex-husband died last Sunday night. Quite suddenly, my 16 and 13-year-olds are devastated. Our family and friends have mobilized. We are well supported. My feelings are more complicated. As Dave was an addict and actively using when he died. In a world turned upside down twist, although we were separated for nearly 2 years and in the process of divorcing, we were still legally married, and it's very messy. Since then, the Santa Clara County Medical Examiner has confirmed that Dave died of acute cocaine and fentanyl toxicity, an overdose. Since 2010, I'd kept his substance abuse a secret. I'd kept secret the relapses, the erratic and abusive behavior, the financial irresponsibility, and most gut-wrenching of all, the fear that I, or worse, the kids, would find him dead. That fear was deeply rooted and was persistent. But here's the thing. As soon as I experienced that nightmare scenario, fear released its grip. And that was my aha. I realized that this secret I've been keeping had been sucking the vitality out of me for years. And our most precious resource is not time, and it is certainly not money. It is energy. And we need all the energy we have, 100% we can nurture and access to be our best selves and show up in all the roles we play in our lives. We can't let secrets burn it up. So today I can tell you we're doing well. There's a celebration of life in July. My kids return to school in January. They are creative, kind teenagers adjusting to this life twist. It was epically scary for me to tell this story. The response has been the fiercest of empathy and love and connection. I've gotten lovely notes from those colleagues who I wrote to. They've shared their stories about addiction in their families and losing their parents young, a finance colleague, a fellow Haasie, offered gratitude and appreciation for the bravery it took to be vulnerable and share what I was going through. And the energy that I reclaimed, the payoff of that energy reclaimed, from talking about things I never thought I could, is entirely worth it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you.
Tanny gave me the least emotional group. Thanks a lot. I mean, what would you do if you released some of your fear? What would happen if you turned to the person you work next to every day and shared something that feels really scary to share? It freed Alice up to let go of that fear. We live in such a divisive world. We're consistently othering and judging and making assumptions. And I won't go off on my DEI tangent because we have another speaker. Last but not least, but is it again, hashtag Haas alumni, hashtag Haas reunion, we have Laura Teclamarium. The title of her talk is Road to Opportunity. She's an executive MBA class of 2018 graduate, a 20-year veteran with a high-tech, in the high-tech experience, sorry. She is a 20-year veteran with high-tech experience in product management, interactive media design, and software development. She's worked at a few large companies, amongst them Netflix, Warner Brothers, EA, and now she's recently just gone to LinkedIn. At LinkedIn, she's responsible for profile and messaging products, I think just a few. In addition to championing the product vision for the digital professional representation of billions of members and counting, she's responsible for building innovative products that help members of the global workforce access economic opportunity, the road to opportunity. Laura.
Okay, my name is Laura Teclamarium. I want to give a shout out to class of 2018, if you're in the stands. Awesome. I would love to ask two questions to start us off. Please raise your hand if you are on your journey, your career journey. Raise your hand. Okay, I see you. Handsome hands here. Okay, and then my second question is, please raise your hand if you've reached your destination. Okay, there's some hands. I see those hands. Okay, I see you. All right. Well, with that, I'd love to tell you my story. Is that okay? Awesome. So, I was born in Oakland, California, and raised in Vallejo, California, a Bay Area native. I was raised by a single mother who was an immigrant, came here to America, and she worked double shifts to take care of my sister and I, graveyards and all. I grew up wearing Payless Keds and Kmart clothes. For those of you who don't know what either of those stores are now, they were basically low-income clothes. And I loved watching Saturday morning cartoons so much. I mean, back in the days, in case you don't know, you had to wake up at 7 a.m. to watch cartoons. And like the whole U.S. was glued to the all your kids were glued to the TV at 7 a.m. I also loved to play video games. And my mom saw that spark so much so that she worked hard to make sure that if I got straight A's every semester, she would give me a video game. So, I'm gonna tell you my story about the road to opportunity. Obsessed with the journey, not the destination. These are the memories of my childhood. I loved these shows. I loved playing these games. Every morning, I religiously woke up to go to them. But then, when I thought about it, there was something inside me at 8 years old that I said, I'm frustrated. and I couldn't quite figure out what I was frustrated about with the things I loved so much. I was frustrated that I didn't see myself in these stories. I didn't see my mother, who was working two-hour shifts, in this narrative. I didn't see my sister, my friends, my neighbors, but I loved these stories. And so I took that on with me, trying to figure out why I loved these stories, but I was so frustrated. I went on to graduate from University of California, Irvine, and I started developing a reason of why I felt so frustrated. And I tried to really hone in on this thesis. And I said, I think it's what we see impacts our imagination. Each of you have an imagination. Each of you have been influenced by what you see. That influence then changes the way you think. And the way you think changes the systems that you build and impact. So for example, academic, we're all here at Haas, right? We're all here. Some of you are impacting academic institutions. Some of you are impacting financial institutions. Some of you are impacting judicial institutions. And it all started when you were young, as a kid, waking up at 7 a.m., watching those cartoons or playing those games. And so, fast forward, it's 2017. I just decided to go to MBA school. I'm a level one senior manager. This was 5 years ago. And I said, okay, what do I need to do to figure out my career? And I wanted to map out my journey, but I realized there were so many destinations that I could go. And so I said, you know what? Let me not try to write out a linear career path. I'm going to write out a non-linear map and place all the destinations I could go. I was a senior manager at the time, and I was like, maybe one day I'll be CEO, maybe one day I'll be a director, maybe one day I'll go into tech, maybe one day I'll stay in entertainment, maybe one day I'll work at Netflix. And so with that, what I'd say is I learned that journeys are not linear, they're non-linear, and they can take you to multi-destinations. All right, so I'm at EA, and I get to work on Star Wars franchise, and this is a game that went on to make hundreds of millions of dollars per year. So I'm sitting in R&D in the development room, and I want to play this game, and it's a battler. You need to have five characters. I could not even create a battle squad with five female characters. And so yet again, another moment, I don't see myself in this story. How can I change this? So, if you know Star Wars and you're a fan of Star Wars, the canon's very hard to change. But we eventually changed which characters we used so that we could make an all-female squad. So great, I've made it. I've changed the biggest franchise at EA, well known. I've made it to my destination. I'm done. I'm here. I've arrived. Or have I? Have I made it to that final destination? Fast forward again, I'm at Netflix. And it's Saturday morning, 7 a.m. And I'm sitting now with my three daughters, and we're watching our cartoons. I now am the director of product of animation and control product for all animation at Netflix. And as we're watching these cartoons, my five-year-old, who I had in the MBA program, says to me, Mommy, look, I see this character. This is me. Did you make this for me? And that's you, Mommy. And for the first time, I finally saw my story. I finally saw my friends. I finally saw my neighbors, my classmates. And at that moment, I said, I think I'm done, right? I've made it. This has been a long journey in the making since those 7 a.m. cartoons that my mom worked so hard for me to provide for me. I've made it to my destination. Well, or at least I thought. So then I went on and said, but what if I could impact more than millions or hundreds of millions? What if there's billions of people out there that I could impact? What if I could impact the way people imagine how you get jobs? Or if I could impact the way you sell products? Or if I could impact the customers you get? Or who you hire? Or who hires you? What if I could change imagination across 8 billion people across the world? What if? So, I went to LinkedIn and I went and took a position to where I now own the vision for profile and messaging. And I serve billions of members. And so here's my point. Careers are long. Life is full of destinations. And so I'd love to end where I began, which is asking you two questions. Are you on your journey, or have you arrived to your destination? With that, I'm obsessed with my journey and not the destination. Thank you for hearing my story.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm going to ask all the speakers to come up, please. I'm going to ask Francesca LeBaron, who coached these fabulous speakers, to come up. I'm going to ask Tanny, whose idea this was, to come up. And now I'm going to make you all incredibly uncomfortable while I talk. Amazing, right? One more round of applause. So I love to just pull things together and try to create a theme. But Benny gave me Chat GPT. So Chat GPT wrote my notes, and here's what Chat GPT says. One of the leadership models that I designed and teach, really based around the world of inclusion, is it's called the VUCA model. Now, some of you are like, there's already a VUCA model. Warren Bennis, you know, I think he's like a 99-year-old man, designed VUCA. Does anybody know the VUCA leadership model? Volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. It was actually developed for the US military during the fall of the USSR. So those conditions, volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous, might sound vaguely familiar. At the beginning of COVID, I was on a faculty call truly and heard that VUCA come back up. And the comment was, we need to teach VUCA again. And I'm thinking, wow, it's kind of weird that we're looking at a militaristic leadership model right now. And so in my mind, I thought, you know, my research says that we do need VUCA leaders with an extra C. In order for leaders to be the most effective leader today, it is leaders who choose, and these are all choices, right? Choose to get vulnerable, to get uncomfortable, to be courageous, to be curious, and to hold themselves and others accountable. So I have all these beautiful notes, but like what makes me get teary is welcome to VUCA leadership right here. Right? So, but I do have three asks. You know it's Berkeley. We're a broke, large public institution. The first ask is actually very serious. Please hire Haas. Can you imagine? I know everybody says, well, I graduated in 2003 and I graduated in 2008 and I was out there in 2013. It's a tough time to graduate. So if you can hire, if you know somebody who can hire, if you can just be a career counselor or coach, the folks are really nervous who are graduating. So hire Haas, and I know many of you consistently do, so thank you for that. That's the first ask. Think about hiring Haas. The second is join your Haas networks. We become such a stronger school because of our alums and the alumni networks that Tenny and team put so much time and effort into. And then finally, support us by investing in Haas. And I know many of you have already. We really appreciate that. Just keep coming back. It's just so great to feel the energy. Like I said, you know, I didn't get to Peloton this morning because I decided to clean my kitchen floor instead. And I'm like, all Saturday, it's sunny, it's beautiful. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity with these speakers to be here today. We'll see you on the courtyard.